welcome everybody. On behalf of Catherine Henn, Library Director, and the Board of Library Trustees, we welcome you this afternoon to the Sunderland Public Library. This event is also sponsored by the Sunderland Energy Committee, chaired by Laura Williams here, Scott Reed, and who's up there? So we're happy to see such a good turnout on a beautiful Saturday afternoon. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Representative Stephen Kulik. Steve was first elected to the Massachusetts House of Representatives in 1993, and he represents 19 towns in the 1st Franklin District, which includes parts of Hamden, Hampshire, and Franklin counties. It's the second largest district in the state. And he is currently in his 12th term, which I think is testimony to the great job he's been doing. Steve, indeed, has been a leader on many issues that are important to his district, including public education, economic development, health care, food and agriculture, and especially germane to this afternoon's discussion, energy and the environment. Steve Kulik is presently Vice Chair of the House Ways and Means Committee, an influential position with responsibilities that include helping to craft the state's annual budget. He is a member of several legislative caucuses that focus on issues of importance to this region, and he is active in several regional and national organizations involved in state and federal policy affecting agriculture, water resources, the environment, trade, and other issues. I know that many people in this region are very interested in matters pertaining to renewable energy, and indeed, Massachusetts has been a leader in the nation as far as renewable energy is concerned. In fact, Massachusetts has been ranked number one in the nation in energy efficiency by the American Council for an Energy Efficient Economy. But in recent weeks and months, there has been some concern among people that some of the key economic incentives that have made Massachusetts a leader in renewable energy, especially in the solar energy realm, have stalled. Such key economic incentives include the SREC program, the solar renewable energy credits, as well as the arrangement for net metering for photovoltaic electric hookups. I have here some letters of grave concern from the Massachusetts Municipal Association, with which Steve has been associated, as well as key leaders in the solar energy industry. And just recently, the town of Northampton has passed a resolution strongly opposing the caps on net metering and the fees connected with the net metering distribution credits. Also before the legislature, there are other bills pertaining to the Omnibus Energy Bill, which may also have provisions in it regarding biomass and other issues important to people in the region. Certainly of great concern these days is the proposed gas pipeline, and if renewable energy is not strong in this region, people are concerned that the opposition to that project may not be as strong as it should be. So I thought to myself, who better than Steve Kulik to fill us in as to the future of renewable energy in the state? As you well know, Steve is honest, open, and forthright in his politics, and I know from my own experience that he's a good listener. We hope to leave plenty of time for questions and discussion. So it is my great privilege now to present to you Representative Steve Kulik.
Thank you very much, and it's so nice to see a full room on a beautiful Saturday afternoon to talk about such important issues as these. And thank you for that really kind introduction. It was overly generous. I assure you there are plenty of people probably in this room who know a lot more about particular energy issues than I do, but it is something that I've always worked on. In fact, I see my very old and dear friend Paul Newlin over here from Waitley, who in the late 70s and early 80s, and Chris Smith over here in the same time period, We were working on renewable energy and energy conservation stuff in the valley, and I was working for the Hampshire County Energy Office, the Franklin County Energy Office. There were a lot of great community energy programs going on at that time in the Carter administration that began, and they all disappeared when Ronald Reagan became president. We've seen energy interest and the investments made in renewable energy and conservation ebb and flow over the years, depending on who's in power, it seems, in Washington. And that's a shame, because had many of those commitments that began 35 years ago continued steadily, then we wouldn't be in the situation we are now, where we're looking at the negative impacts of fossil fuel use on our climate, on our environment in general, and diminishing resources. We'd be much further ahead today than we are, but that shouldn't slow us down from doing as much as we can today. So again, it's really great to see such a turnout from all over my district and elsewhere. I see people from at least 10 communities I represent here, so it's very gratifying to see you. I thought we'd keep this very informal today, and there are some more chairs being put out in front here if any of you in the back want to come up. And I thank the library and the Energy Committee for hosting this and providing refreshments. Feel free to get up and get refreshments while we're talking. But so I wanted to keep it pretty informal, give you an update on what's happening in the legislature right now, what we expect over the next few months, how you can be actively involved in some of the decision making that's taking place. And then really, I'd like it to be a dialogue with you. I'd like to hear your thoughts and concerns, your priorities, anything you think I should know that I may not know. And believe me, there are lots of things I don't know about different aspects of the energy field, but it is something that's going to be very much on the agenda in the next 4 months or 5 months of the legislative session. Before I get into that, I just wanted to also introduce my legislative aide, Paul Dunphy. If Paul could raise your hand here, many of you, thank you. Many of you may know Paul, who has been with me now almost 10 years, I think, 9 years or so. He lives in Williamsburg, and he's my district director here. So when I'm in Boston, you call my office or reach out for anything, you're likely to get Paul on the other end of the line. So he's glad to have him here today, too. So, what's going on in the legislature? A couple of things that are of particular interest. Certainly there are a number of energy bills that are in committee. The Committee on Telecommunications, Energy and Utilities is the primary committee that deals with energy issues. We also have a committee on global warming and climate change, so some bills go there, but predominantly energy policy measures go to this other committee. And the Senate chair is a Western Mass guy, Ben Downing, state senator, my personal state senator over in Worthington, who does a great job, has always been interested in energy policy. Unfortunately, he's retiring from the legislature at the end of this term. It's going to be a big loss, I think, for Western Mass and for the issues that we care about in the field of energy policy. But Ben chairs that committee and tends to be the person who really leads on a lot of these issues. And so his committee right now is looking at several bills that have been filed, most prominently perhaps one by the governor. And there's also a bill filed by Representative Patricia Dann, who's the Speaker pro tem in the House. Her bill and the governor's bill largely deal with transmission issues, energy transmission with offshore wind, with hydro in Quebec. Not so much with solar, that's a little separate issue we'll talk about, but all of these other bills that are in committee right now are moving towards the creation of an omnibus energy bill or a comprehensive energy bill that may deal with wind and biomass and might deal with solar, mostly offshore wind. We can talk about that a little bit because I know in this area there's a lot of opposition to land-based wind energy. And there was a bill that former Governor Patrick had filed a few years ago to try to stimulate more onshore land-based wind energy, and there was tremendous opposition here in Franklin County to that and ever passed. So most of the wind energy proposals that we hear about now are offshore. So an omnibus energy bill, which we thought when we set this date up might be out by now, is not out. But we expect it sometime in March. And it's going to be, I think, one of the dominant issues that we face as we go towards the end of the legislative session, which ends at the end of July. And we'll probably go right down to the wire. It's kind of very large, very complex bill that takes a lot of time to work on. And if it comes out in March, I would not be surprised if it's not really considered in the House and Senate until we both are finished with budget debate. That's really the dominant thing that's going on right now in the legislature, preparing our version of the FY17 state budget. The governor proposed his budget a few weeks ago. We're conducting hearings on the budget right now, the Joint Senate and House Ways and Means Committees. And the House will be proposing its budget the middle of April, and the Senate about a month later. And then we send those two budgets, which are usually very different, to conference committee, and hopefully to the governor by the beginning of the fiscal year, July 1st. So probably after the budget is when we'll really deal with the energy issue. In the meantime, of course, I know many of you, I've talked with a large number of you about the issue of net metering, which is much more immediate and will hopefully be settled before the omnibus energy bill comes out. So net metering, the sort of status of it being in limbo now, is really harming our solar industry. I see some solar a business in the back here, who you're probably feeling that to some degree. And it's unfortunate because, as was mentioned in the introduction, Massachusetts has led the way nationally. We're number one in terms of our adoption of solar and our very aggressive targets for adoption of solar and decreasing our reliance on fossil fuels. Do you want a chair?
I can't.
Okay, well, we'll get you a chair. You can sit a little closer. I can try to speak a little louder, but there's a chair. You can sit right next to me if you want.
Anything for attention.
Okay, good.
Somebody behind somebody.
That's great. Okay. So where we are in the net metering bill is that back in 2015, the House passed a version, the Senate passed a version in July, I should say. It was a bill that was, the chief sponsor was Senator Ben Downing, aforementioned senator from the Berkshires and Western Franklin County. And Ben's bill is a bill that I co-sponsored. I think it's a really responsible bill, which I think really sets us up for continuing Massachusetts leadership in the adoption of solar. That bill was attached in the Senate to a bill that deals with climate adaptation, which we can also talk about a little bit. But one of the things we need to be doing, as we recognize that our climate is changing, is to put in place plans, contingency plans, to adapt our cities and towns, our land use patterns, our communities to deal with them. And so the solar bill was attached to that. The House came up with a different version, which we did in November, towards the end of our 2015 session. The Senate then adopted a different version to try to come closer to where the House was, and that went to a conference committee, and that conference committee is still meeting to try to resolve the differences between the House and Senate bill. And I spoke to members of the conference committee just this week, and they're hopeful that they will complete their work prior to the emergence of an omnibus energy bill. And I think that's really important because so many projects are on hold, particularly large-scale municipal and community solar projects. This really doesn't affect your individual residential projects, but in terms of the kinds of community projects that so many of our towns are thinking about, the kind you might see in Waitley, for example, already installed, are in jeopardy unless we do the right thing and raise the cap or eliminate the caps completely on solar, which is, I think, a reasonable thing to do. Now, why should we limit the amount of solar energy that can be a part of our energy picture. It doesn't make much sense, but there's a lot of pushback, as you would guess, from utilities, from industries, from the major lobbying effort that's going on right now on Beacon Hill to try to scale back our leadership in solar. And that's really where the battle lines are drawn. They're drawn really between people who believe in a renewable energy future and the status quo of an energy derived from major utilities and distributed over the grid. So, energy that's derived from the sun, that's, I'm trying to think of the word, Chris, distributive energy, is that what I'm thinking of? Or
DG.
DG, right. Distributed generation just slipped my mind, is what the utilities and many, many businesses, primarily represented by Associated Industries of Massachusetts, AIMS, and a number of other major corporate types of entities, have been putting out a big push. And if you were in the Boston area, I don't know how much there's been out here, but there's been a lot of advertising on television, on radio, multi-millions of dollars being spent to argue that Massachusetts taxpayers or ratepayers are subsidizing the solar industry. And that's absolutely not the case. We're not subsidizing the solar industry. And there have been some really insidious kinds of arguments made that particularly low-income people, low-income ratepayers, are subsidizing the solar industry. Also not true. There's nothing but a benefit to all of us to have a greater reliance on solar energy and other renewable resources as well.
Could you go into a little more detail about how it's not true?
The subsidy?
Yeah.
Yeah. So some of the arguments that have been made are that that through our rates we are subsidizing people who have solar, and that that's built into our rates. And so if you don't have solar, if your roof doesn't point in the right direction or you don't have access to it yourself, that we are subsidizing people who do.
Right, so how do you prove that's not true?
Well, it's not, one could say that there's some subsidy there, but it's not as big as what the utilities say it is. They're claiming it's over 50 cents. Chris, if you don't mind, I'm going to ask Chris, because he's an expert on these numbers.
Okay. So, I'm Christopher Smith. I'm with the Mass Solar Owners Association, and we're working with Steve and other to try to straighten out these myths.
Yeah.
To understand solar, on your bill, you'll see whether you're evergreen or natural grid, you'll see this little component that says solar, repayment of solar, and so on. This is based, what you're actually paying for are estimates, okay? Based on what the utilities think they're losing by us producing solar. That's what you're paying for, not the actual solar. The solar, in 2008, when the Green Communities Act was written, the authors at the time said, what is the value of solar? Do we know? We need a value of solar study. Well, in 2008, the only people who had done anything remotely were in Oregon. And they said, how does that apply to Massachusetts? We need an independent study. There was no money to do it. So the fallback was to say, well, we know it's worth more than 3 cents that is paid for coal and oil, but how high should we go? So they said, we don't know. How about we say it's the same amount as what the utilities sell the neighbors of your solar system? So actually, the utilities get paid twice. Okay? Once for selling it to your neighbors, and twice based on overestimates for what they didn't sell you. And if that isn't outrageous, then you get things like NGrid and Eversource, Pound May, and so on. By the way, we've got $19 million bonus this year for raising your electric rates.
He's the president and CEO of Eversource, for those of you.
Okay, he turns around and says, all of this is going to cost the Commonwealth $780 billion, okay, for solar. he says this, but then he doesn't turn around and he says, so when you push back, you say, but Tom, what about the value of solar we're putting back on the grid? That has no value, he says. We don't see that as having any value. So therefore, it's a subsidy. It's an outrage. It's an outrage.
Yeah. And that's the argument they're making on Beacon Hill and through the general public through some very expensive advertising, sophisticated advertising. And I've talked about this with some of you already, that in some ways they've been winning that debate. They've been winning that debate on Beacon Hill. And I think that's part of the reason that we sort of have gridlock at the moment in terms of trying to move forward and continue our success with solar. Because that concept that people are subsidizing the increasing market in solar has really gotten some traction. And it's a false argument. It's not one that should be getting the credence that it does. It does, just doesn't have that credibility, but it has. So there is a major effort from groups like the Mass Solar Owners, other environmental organizations, the Environmental League of Massachusetts, the Sierra Club, Environment Massachusetts. There's a large coalition of more than 60 organizations that are pushing back on that and doing a lot of grassroots lobbying, which all of you can participate in. Probably we'll later on tell you a little bit about some of the organizations that you can get good information and so on. And many of you have written to me and to your own legislators, if I'm not your state rep, to try to encourage us to get the conference committee to adopt what was essentially that first bill that the Senate had passed, Senator Downing's bill, which would set us on a good path to meet our climate goals under the Global Warming Solutions Act, which was passed several years ago and would set clean energy goals for us, to do it in a way that doesn't increase our reliance on fossil fuels, that doesn't rely on Canadian hydro. That's probably going to be a part of the mix, but it can't be another foreign energy resource that we learn to rely on. All of this conversation is also tied in to the pipeline issue, not surprisingly, because we have multi-billion dollar corporations pushing the pipeline, two pipeline projects really, but the one we're most concerned about is the NED project that would move through Western Franklin County up into New Hampshire and then back into Massachusetts. That presents a very real threat and is intertwined in our conversations about renewable energy and energy efficiency in Massachusetts. You know, there may be more natural gas as part of the mix. I'm not convinced. There needs to be additional study on that, although our really terrific Attorney General Maura Healey came out with a study last year, which said that the demand for more natural gas in Massachusetts is a false argument, that we don't need it, that it's really based on a few days of peak demand in the coldest days of the winter, maybe 12 days or thereabouts on average. We didn't really see it this year. We didn't really see it last year. The year before, there was an increase in demand, but that demand could be met with other resources. It can be met with more solar. Distributed generation. It can be met with maybe offshore wind, with some creative use of environmentally safe biomass, with more conservation. That's one of the things that I hope to add into the omnibus energy bill, is a component to do more residential conservation. I'm going to propose a program to allow municipalities to get into a financing program. It's been very successful in California and a few other states, a residential PACE program it's called, which will allow you to finance, working with your town at local option, to finance significant energy improvements, because conservation is the least expensive and most efficient way to reduce our energy footprint. So that should be part of the omnibus energy bill, and I'm hoping that it will be. So I mentioned pipelines. That's one of the things that's so important. It's not an accident or not a coincidence that Eversource and National Grid are major players in pushing back against the net metering bills. That it helps to justify their argument for more natural gas. And of course, we can argue against the NED pipeline from so many aspects, from its public safety aspects, from the environmental impacts on both public and private land. But the basic lack of a compelling argument to have it is, to me, probably the most compelling. Less than 40% so far of the capacity of the NED pipeline is contracted, that we know where it's going to go, whether it's to Berkshire Gas or one of the other local gas distribution companies. Many people in this area are so convinced and concerned that the majority of gas that might move through that pipeline is destined for overseas export. I'm convinced it has to be, because there's just no way we can consume that much gas in Massachusetts, particularly if two pipeline projects, the Spectra project and the NED, were both approved by FERC, which hopefully they would not be, but it speaks to nothing other than a plan which has not been made public to export this gas. And that would more than damage, that would set us back. It would have no benefit, certainly, for the communities that would host this pipeline passing through our towns in Western Massachusetts. But it also wouldn't provide the rate relief that the companies argue would be a result of the gas pipeline and extra gas supplies. They say, well, we need it to reduce the rates. Increase supply, reduce the rates. People are still thinking about the very high spikes in gas prices of a couple of years ago. However, if we're exporting 50% or so of the gas that's moving through that pipeline, they're willing to pay a lot more for it in Europe, overseas, wherever it may be destined. So if they're getting more money for it there, it's going to drive up the price that those of us as ratepayers are going to pay for it here. And another insidious part of that is that even though we may not, I live in a town that has no central gas supply, many of you do, not all of you, but in terms of the benefit to those of us here as energy consumers, we're just not going to see it. But they want all of us as electric rate payers to pay for the construction of that pipeline. Now, what's wrong with that picture? They said they're going to use it to generate more electricity, to replace some of the capacity that's coming offline, whether it be coal or nuclear, the closure of Vermont Yankee, that again will reduce rates because we're going to have more electrical generation by natural gas. So another fossil fuel, another contributor to climate change, another out-of-state import rather than relying on in-state distributed generation through solar or through other renewable means and conservation, is what we need to be working towards. And it's a big argument, it's a real fight. It's going to be a big fight over the next 5 months on Beacon Hill. So, you know, your involvement, your interest, which, you know, it's very heartening, again, to see so many people here that are interested in these subjects, because it's going to take citizen involvement, I think, to turn the needle on this, to be able to counteract the arguments and the advertisements and the lobbying being made by Eversource and National Grid and Kinder Morgan and all of their allies. So that's kind of where we're at. I see people wanting to say some things. So as I said, I want this to be a conversation. And I'm kind of giving you an overview, I think, of some of the issues facing us in the legislature. And I'd love to just open it up now, and I'll go around in the order I see hands. Yours was the first, and then we'll come to you. Yes?
Well, a number of us have been working against the pipeline, if you want. And I'm just wondering, is there any percentage that's going to make any difference? How much belief do you think that it might? I mean, we're dealing with FERC, which is this huge organization, right. And are they really listening to us, and do they really listen to citizens?
So, that's an excellent question. I have a mix of skepticism with some optimism on that issue. It is generally true that FERC has never turned down a proposal like this.
They've never seen one they didn't like, right?
Right. However, I don't think they've ever seen opposition like they're seeing in Massachusetts, which is really well informed. It's not just not in my backyard stuff. These are real concerns. They're not only public safety concerns or concerns about people's diminished property values if they're near a pipeline. It's really about energy policy. It's about people paying more for fossil fuel that doesn't set us ahead, as I mentioned in the beginning. If we had made certain steps 40 years ago and continued on that path, no one would be talking about a gas pipeline at this point. And so I think we're well positioned to make these arguments before FERC in a way that maybe other projects elsewhere in the country have not been made. You know, I was thinking back upon when I first learned about this pipeline, and 2 years ago, next Saturday, was the first meeting I went to. Jim Cutler, you were probably there, in Covington. It was March 8th, 2014, and it was the first big gathering at the Covington Community House about the pipeline. And it was an overflow crowd, standing room only, and it was just the first hints of rumor and information coming out about the pipeline. And since that time, I've just never seen a movement grow of people not just sort of peripherally interested, but deeply engaged in learning about the negative aspects of this project, being really well informed. Some of you may have been to some of the DPU hearings that were held in Greenfield, or the so-called open house that Kinder Morgan had at Greenfield Community College. And so people are engaging, they're staying that way, and they really need to continue that, because I think this is winnable. I think that I've always felt that the best arguments against this project are going to be economic ones. If we can prove that it's unnecessary and uneconomical for the company to build it. Remember, they want you to pay for it.
Yes.
So if we can stop that from happening and say that they would have to pay for it. If they had to pay for it, they wouldn't build it. I don't think. You know. So there's a lot of organizations. The one I'm most familiar with and work with all the time is the Plan New England Pipeline Awareness Network. Katie Eisman, many of you may have heard her speak or know her. They do terrific work. They're funding interventions. They can use more money, by the way, if anyone wants to contribute to them. It's a really worthy cause because these are very expensive. Remember, we're on the other side are people, corporations with really, really deep pockets who are funding this. And I mean, they have no budgetary limitations for what they can spend to advance this project. But I do think that citizen action that's well-informed, that's legally sound, will have an impact. I'm really optimistic about that. Yes.
We have a big battle with FERC, and I'm just wondering what is the best way to go about informing them, because they're not listening to the human beings that they're supposed to represent. I'm not sure what I want to say, but I just think that FERC is, you know, they met a pipeline they didn't like, kind of thing. What should we do to tell FERC, to let them know that this is not the right thing to do? What do we do to FERC to let them know that fossil fuel is not the way to go? I mean, this is an organization that got promoted, that got organized by the federal government. And they've gone amok. They've really gone amok.
I agree. You know, FERC has been given such enormous power.
And how do we tell
going
them
back
that
to the,
the power is our power, the people's power, not theirs? How do we tell them? What do we do?
Write to them, for sure.
We've done that.
Yeah, well, that is part of the record, and it's part of the argument that they're hearing, without question. And
they've got over 1,700 interveners.
Yeah, how many of you signed up to intervene in?
Yeah.
Pretty impressive.
Yeah, that's the most they've ever done. But are they going to listen to us? This is so frustrating, because I've been to meetings, I've been to all sorts of things. If FERC will just turn around and say, it's public domain, it's good for the gross national product.
Well, it's why our arguments, our legal arguments, have to be so solid and based on economics and finances and the environmental issues against it. And I think those are
economic issues.
Yeah, they do. That's
so that's what I'm asking. What do we do to inform them that the economic issue is not the issue of this pipeline?
Well, this is all going to be part of the arguments that various interveners are making before the FERC proceeding, which is now formally underway and will take a year or so. So These arguments are at the forefront, and we can only hope that with continued pressure and continued information into FERC, that they will just, we can't guarantee it. I mean, I say skepticism tempered with some optimism as well, but.
Who gave this organization that much power?
Congress.
George Bush.
Congress. So I think it goes back to the federal Gas Act, which I think was in the 70s. Jim, you know about that?
Well, 38, and then it revised in 2005.
Oh, 2005, okay. That's what gives them such extraordinary unilateral power.
So they can mess up our environment for what benefit?
Well,
that's a question. Right.
I can't answer for FERC, but I think what they're looking at is, does this region, is there a justification for more natural gas resources in the region? That's what they're going to base their decision on. So our challenge is to prove that it's not justified. Yeah, Andrew.
Andrew Baker, I'm from Shelburne, and I wanted to go back to the solar end of the conversation, and you had made a couple of statements that I wanted to just follow on. One was that you thought the net metering issue might be resolved outside the energy bill, so in a little more detail on that.
Sure.
The other was that you thought the solar was kind of on the back end of this whole conversation. So and I'll tell you what my concern is. The town of Shelburne and Coleraine and Conway have now partnered together to form a solarized mass project, which we're just getting underway. We're reaching out to hundreds of people, some of them in your district. And there's a lot of interest out there, but the deal is very unclear of what, for an individual homeowner, it would mean to put panels on their roof. We know the federal tax credit is in place for the next 5 years. We don't know about net metering, and we don't know about the solar renewable energy credits, the SRECs. So those three components are really, and the fourth is really whether or not the utilities will be successful in imposing a minimum charge on all customers, including solar generators. So those are kind of the four pieces that really determine whether and how economical it is for somebody to spend thousands of dollars to put solar panels on their roof. And we only know one of those right now. So we're about to launch this project, which the state of Massachusetts is, you know, encouraging us to do, but we don't yet know what to tell people. And so, how are we going to get clarity on that?
So the competing net metering bills that I mentioned, one passed by the House, one passed by the Senate, are in a conference committee. So there are three state reps and three state senators on that conference committee that are now meeting to try to resolve those differences and come up with a final version, which will be presented to the legislature, to the House and Senate, for an up or down vote. It can't be amended any further once a conference committee report is released like that. They're hoping to complete that before we do the omnibus energy bill, because there's more of an immediate need with the projects that are on hold around the state. I've talked to major solar developers who are talking about just pulling out of Massachusetts and investing in other states right now, projects that they would normally be building later this year or next year. So the uncertainty is creating a lot of volatility in the market that's having a negative impact. And this is really on a larger scale projects primarily. So let's see if I can remember each of your points. But on the SREC, the solar renewable credits, that issue may be dealt with in this bill. But if the net metering issue is dealt with, the Baker administration has the ability to develop the next phase, the next generation of the SREC program on its own. They could do that today, actually, and bring some clarity to that situation going forward. But they want to wait until the net metering issue is dealt with, because it's all part of the same financial piece that affects a decision on developing a project.
So you're saying the net metering is going to get resolved by the joint conference committee?
Yes.
And perhaps on the front end of the energy bill process.
Yep.
So that would be like March, April?
Hopefully very soon.
Okay.
Yeah, hopefully before, March, April is kind of what I'm thinking.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can I add a comment to
yes.
that? So in terms of that conference committee, it's really, the House is the sticking point right now, and it's very important for everyone to contact their representatives. Steve Kulik's already signed on to a Dear Colleague letter that's going to each conference committee member asking that there be no minimum bill and that the net
minimum meter charge.
Yeah, minimum charge, right. Or minimum,
it's, yeah. it's called the minimum bill.
Oh, okay, thank
it is,
you.
Yeah. It affects the minimum charge or a fixed
yeah.
charge, yes.
Yeah.
And also to set the net metering rate, the credit, at full retail. And then the net metering cap to raise that at least by 5%, if not eliminated. That's only going to come back and bite you guys later if you don't rate eliminate it. But and then the fourth thing is the incentives, which is the SREX. And what Steve said is absolutely true, although what we've heard through the governor's office is that they are absolutely opposed to extending SREC 2 as it stands right now. I can't remember the rationale. It's something along the lines of that if you extend it, it's kind of just like giving something without enough foresight, and that actually DOER, which is in control of the regulations for SREC 2, could have started a sequential program because they could have known that just by counting how fast SREC 2 was selling out and filling up, and that they would have known basically back in November that they needed to start these regulatory processes to get SREC 3 or whatever a new process would be going. But that none of that has happened, and I completely blame the governor's office. So there's an effort that everyone involved needs to let the governor know that we are watching and paying attention and tell him that we want DOER to step up and get the next incentive program, at least the structure. They don't need the actual dollar amounts figured out because they actually do need to know what the net metering credit amount is before they can set the incentive. But we also need some kind of a stopgap. And I say we in terms of everyone who wants to install solar. I'm Claire Chang at the Solar Store of Greensville. We install solar all over Franklin County. And a lot of our projects are on hold. And so in order to move all that forward and get into 2017, the new regulations won't be in place until at the earliest January 2017. So to get something in the meantime, the governor needs to act. And I don't see that Governor Baker has been very receptive to doing anything in particular. So everyone, there needs to be a groundswell. He's not going to do anything unless people get up in his face and say, this is what we want. And you also do need to tell him you don't want a minimum bill. That is completely a camel's nose under the tent, trying to get in. If it were legislatively pegged to some really minuscule amount, like $5 or $10, it would make no difference to the utilities. The only way it would make any difference to the utilities is if it was $25, $35 a month. And that is just astronomical and completely anti-solar. There's just no other way to say it. It's also anti-energy efficiency. If you believe that energy conservation is the megawatt that we need to use and it's the cheapest way to reduce our dependence on fossil fuels, then having a minimum bill completely works against any of your conservation or energy efficiency concepts.
Well said, Claire. yes, sir.
I'm just curious, it seems like putting your budget process before you debate your energy policy kind of limits it from the get-go, doesn't it?
Well, the budget process basically follows the same calendar every year, and we work other major bills, like the energy bill, around it. It really can't deviate very much because we have an absolute deadline, or hoped-for deadline, July 1st, beginning of the fiscal year, to get the budget completed. So, we follow a pretty standard schedule every year. The House releasing a budget April 15th, thereabouts, debating it the last week of April. The Senate releasing a budget just before Memorial Day and debating it before Memorial Day. And then trying to resolve it in the month of June to complete it. So just because the budget thing is happening doesn't mean other major stuff doesn't happen. But because really the budget is the major issue before us right now for the next couple of months. All I'm saying, not that the energy bill won't come out and won't be getting some attention and have an opportunity for the public to look at it, but in terms of probably debating and adopting the energy bill, it will probably wait till just after the budget is completed, being debated and voted on, which would be Memorial Day roughly. So it's, I mean, multiple things happen at the same time, but just the budget sort of takes over everything else because we're trying to efficiently and wisely spend about $30 billion of your money. So, yes. I'll come to you, but Dana, you have your hand up.
I did. We have a permitted municipal project here in Sunderland that went through the permitting process, I think, in July.
Yeah.
And we're sitting, waiting for Eversource for the interconnection agreement. So I'm just wondering, you know, as this push moves and more and more and more projects get bottlenecked at that point, what's the solution to start to get projects that are permitted,
right,
and good viable projects into construction?
Now, I have to say, Eversource has been a real problem with this. I'm being really polite in my choice of words. But it has been, you know, Jim is from Ashfield and ran the Solarize Ashfield, Buckland, and Plainfield program. And hopefully your project, Andrew, will be as successful as theirs was in terms of, you really oversubscribed your predictions.
Yeah, 110 systems.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Second in the Solarize program.
Yeah, really successful. But all these systems would get installed. I realize yours is a bigger project, but and then people had to wait and wait and wait for the interconnection from Eversource. And it didn't happen that way in the National Grid territory, which were much more speedy, much more on a regular predictable basis. So, you know, I was hearing from folks in the towns, my colleagues as well, we were all calling on the source regularly. They failed to properly staff up to manage this program. And there's no real teeth to any or any penalties to force them. And the DPU does have an officer who wants to hear about these and is building a portfolio of complaints. But they don't have a regulatory, you know, method to fine them or to punish them in some way if they don't meet a reasonable standard of turning those interconnections around. Something we need to work on in the legislature and probably give the DPU that authority to do something like that. So happy to try to work with the DPU and Eversource to move yours along.
Can
Jack,
I
sure.
Sort of add something to that?
Yeah.
I mean, why not go whole hog on this? Up in Vermont, major utility is it's a publicly owned utility. Why don't we just unprivatize Eversource? It's not. It's a Spanish company. It's owned by a Spanish company. Why do we have to sit here and put up with all of this crap? We'll just take it over.
Yeah.
Why not?
There's a lot of interest out there to allowing municipalities to start municipal light companies and do their own. And I think, if I remember my history right, there hasn't been a new one formed in Massachusetts since the late 1920s, something like that. And you could I think several people probably know more about that than I do, want to chime in, but it's a significant change in statute. We'd have to go back and revisit the statute that enables, and I've sponsored a bill every year with a representative from Lexington, who is Jay Kaufman, has taken the lead on this to try to make it easier to form municipal light companies. One of the big sticking points is what you'd have to pay the investor-owned utilities for their assets in your community, and how do you raise that much money? In the long run, over, you know, several decades, it probably makes sense, and it gets you out from under the ownership of an investor-owned utility. It's not an easy issue to tackle because there are probably billions of dollars involved that would have to be transferred from private ownership to public. You've had your hand up for quite a while right there. Yeah. Yes, you.
First of all, thank you for all your work on our behalf with relation to the proposed Northeast Energy Direct. Thank you. In regard to working with the DPU, They seem like a bunch of molds that come up from underground and they kind of blink myopically and then try to go back down because they don't know what to do. Or not only do they not know what to do, they want to fail to act because they are under the influence of these larger entities. And it is my extreme frustration and great fear that the democratic process is being manipulated by Eversource, by National Grid, by Kinder Morgan, and it is absolutely going from the fat boys onto our DPU that sit in those hearings, because I was just there, and they just blink like there's something really wrong with them, and while people pour their hearts out, either with a realistic argument or with true emotion or both, they manage to look at their cell phone and act like they're not even there. So how can we apply pressure to both the DPU and Baker and FERC to get an actual result other than myopic winking? Because I'm getting sick of that.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. I think most of us are, and I've been to some DPU hearings as well, and as you may know, I tried to intervene in. So this DPU that is sitting now is our appointees of Governor Baker. So it's a new administration, 13 to 14 months old now, but some new people came in and they have not been as responsive to citizens as previous DPUs have. So I joined with Pipeline Awareness Network to try to intervene on the precedent agreements that were before them for Berkshire Gas. It's the one I was interested in, but there are others as well. And in previous DPUs, such a collaborative intervention that involved a nonprofit organization, legislators, municipal governments, would have been routinely accepted as given intervener status, which means you get to be there and ask questions, to provide expert testimony, et cetera, again, would have been routinely acknowledged and accepted in previous DPUs. This DPU just, you know, waved their hand and dismissed these cases. They obviously had their minds made up, in my view, of what their position was going to be without hearing the arguments. As a result, I have filed a bill to take away their discretion to make those decisions and accept or deny. The bill I filed would force them to accept such interventions and to listen to the testimony. So that's one thing. And I know that other legislators have been tackling other aspects of the DPU. So I would not be surprised, it may not happen this year, but I wouldn't be surprised if in the next year or two we see some significant changes in DPU procedures and authority that are arising from our continuing frustrations about the decisions they're making, the way they're operating their hearing process.
Well, it appears to show collusion in my estimation.
Yeah.
It also appears that based on the timeline of your bill versus our issues with the proposed Northern Energy Direct, that we're in trouble. And I would like to know if we should continue to work through our AG's office, or if we should have multiple groups on Baker, the DPU, the AG, and all acting simultaneously, in addition to supporting what Claire brought up, to bring pressure. But we need to bring about change quickly.
Yeah.
How could we bring about quicker change than your bill?
Yeah.
How could we do that?
Yeah, the frustrating part of legislation is it usually takes a while, for sure. It's a deliberative process, and you have to get a critical mass of people behind it. But I would continue, I would certainly write to Governor Baker. I would bombard Governor Baker, because with letters on all of these issues, particularly with the regulatory issues of DPU, you know, first of all, let me say I like Governor Baker in terms of working with him over the last few months on a number of other types of issues that he's been very responsive and open to. I've been pleased with their receptivity. But on energy issues, they've been pretty quiet about what their ultimate long-term goal is, what their game plan is. They've been pretty quiet on the NED project. The governor has said a few things that give us some optimism that maybe he might oppose this, if we need more natural gas in Massachusetts, I prefer that it come through existing pipelines. Mm-hmm. Now that would seem to indicate he'd be against spending $5 billion to go through virgin territory and build a new one. But if that's his position, why doesn't he come out and say it? So a lot of us are encouraging him to say that. And yeah, Jim, you have a lot.
Yeah, to add to that, the AG's office just came out that the cost of, and I'm talking now about the tariff on our electric bills to pay for the pipeline. So Maura's saying that it's going to cost over $600,000 to just figure out this whole tariff for the pipeline issue. That's what she's saying is going to cost her office to adjudicate. So here's this crux of the issue. This is the money that they need to build this pipeline. And here we've got the AG's office once again coming out and saying, you know, the whole idea is non-existent, and the idea of paying for it with a tax on our electric bill is even more nonsensical. Yep. So is that not an opportunity to file some kind of resolution or legislation to say that if you're not going to fund solar and fund renewables to the same tune, then you cannot fund a dime to that pipeline?
I like that.
Make him put his money where his mouth is. That's kind of my point.
Right. That's good. I want to get, yes, sir, you had your hand up for a bit. Right there. Lucia.
So, several things, but you did mention pipelines, so I'll save that one for a little bit later. Okay. Regarding solar, you answered my question, I think Claire did as well. Is it, why would you ever consider putting a cap on anything that's free? Mm-hmm. I mean, it just
baffles
the imagination.
Can't make money.
Number one, which tells me what we're really fighting against then are the utility companies, because they are concerned and they are losing money. And if they don't do something different, like maybe get with renewable programs, they're going to continue to lose money. To follow up on the gentleman's comment behind me, where Eversource is a Spanish-held company. I don't know how many people know who owns National Grid, but surprisingly, they are a UK-based company. So none of our major utilities in this area are even US-based, let alone Massachusetts-based. The next question I have gets a little bit more, or statement I have, it's actually, let me follow up on Jim's first, then I'll come back, because I want to give other people a chance to speak. What Maura Healy had said is the cost for litigation on these DPU hearings for the tariff would cost over $600,000. And the Attorney General would in turn put that bill onto the local distribution companies. She said this, that they would most likely in turn then pass that back to the ratepayer. So guess who winds up paying for all this? Mm-hmm. What I'm concerned about is they issued a stay on these hearings on the 24th. The hearing still occurred on the 25th. And is there any feedback as to what's going on? Are they going to continue with these hearings, or are they going to honor the Attorney General's request to stop this until this gets litigated in the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court?
As to whether probably where it's going to go.
It's legal or not for them to do what they think they're going to do.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what they're going to do, whether to continue. They should listen to the Attorney General. The Attorney General is the ratepayer representative. She represents us. She's doing a great job at it. And perhaps the legislature. I'll see if we can weigh in some way, with a group of legislators to try to support her position and their argument on that. It's a good suggestion. Yeah. Thank you. Someone who hasn't spoken yet. I see both. Sure. We'll come down this way. John and then Paul.
Okay. So the first thing that I wanted to say is I wanted to address this woman's point. And I just lost. I had so many things going at once. Let me go back to what this gentleman said in that case, which is the National Grid is a Brit company. Eversource is Spanish-owned. The dams on the Connecticut River just sold from a French company to a Canadian group of investors this week. And all of the dams and hydro facilities on Deerfield are already owned by the Canadians. So we have really gotten ourselves into a mess by selling off all of the infrastructure in this country and completely losing control of it. And we all need to learn from that lesson, become aware of this, and try to stop these processes from happening in the future. What was your major point that you made?
My point is, how do we apply pressure?
That reminded me. A real foot in the door right now is that Montague does have intervener status with the DPU. And Montague has spent a lot of their funds to get intervener status, and they have the ability right now to have expert witness look at the contracts that are before the DPU and try to get that percentage from 40% down to the point where DPU recommends to FERC, don't go forward with this project because they do not have enough contracts in place to make this a viable option. And Montague needs money. They've spent a lot of their own money already. They're going to be spending a lot more going forward. At special town meeting on Monday night, the town of Gill voted to fund $5,000 to help Montague in this legal battle. And I'm hoping that that $5,000 that Gill came up with, not being a ratepayer town, not being a town where the land is being dug up for this project, not being a directly affected town, but just part of this entire region, that sets an example for the other towns in the region to say, Montague has intervener status, let's help them with this legal battle. Mm-hmm. And all these towns should have on their warrants for a special town meeting some type of mechanism to, if not come up with town funds to help Montague in their legal battle, to at least get the conversation started in front of all the people that are at special town meeting to maybe come up with something on their own.
Excellent idea. Thank you, Montague, for... Is anyone here for... Paul, then we'll go to Steve over here.
Yeah, I'm Paul, I live in Waitley. And John, there's so many connections that are being made here. One is that John just mentioned dams along the Deerfield River, et cetera, et cetera. That brings me back to 1980, when I was co-director of the Energy Office for Franklin County. And we had floated a $4 million bond in order to start the Franklin County Power Authority, which was going to take by eminent domain the dams along the Deerfield River, among others, and generate our own power for our own county. We were under the county commissioners at the time were our bosses, and there was an elected member from every town in Franklin County, all 27 towns were on the Energy Committee, pushing this PERPA, the Franklin County Power Authority, to take control and to enact the recommendations by the Franklin County Energy Study in 1978, a multi-year effort at the University of Massachusetts, explaining and documenting how Franklin County could be a net exporter of energy using biomass, wind, and solar and hydro. Well, what happened as soon as we got the legislation made by Rhodes and Grant Boston is that Jerry Mulligan, the head of Northeast Utilities, now Eversource Point, and whatever it is, wrote the county commissioners and asked for us to be disbanded because we had no business in the power business. And so we were disbanded within months after that left. So there have been efforts to create a municipal power authority, and they always get shot down by the same characters. Which, and then somebody mentioned, oh, Steve, you mentioned this is the most, this is the strongest citizen resistance you've seen to this kind of thing. But I remember back in 1975 or so when somebody knocked down a tower. And that's quite a story. I think it was nuclear power, if I remember correctly, which met with quite a lot of resistance. Of course, the problem, well, there's a lot of differences there. I think fossil fuel and greenhouse is even a more insidious problem. But I just wanted to bring to your attention, I would like to see some legislation enabling people, I direct the Solarize project in Waitley. We're doing another campaign. It's not official Solarize. It's just, I wrote up a bunch of facts why you should put solar on your house, and we'll send it out to everybody. But a bunch of us also, including John and Claire, were trying to start a cooperative venture where people who didn't have a roof or didn't own their homes could could take advantage of investing in photovoltaic solar electricity, get the net metering credits, get the SRECs, and get the tax deductions if they bought into a solar cooperative, like a food co-op, maybe a megawatt worth of PVs, and you could buy a certain number of kilowatts and invest for them and get full credits. Well, it just so happens, of course, with our little effort, we ran into some roadblocks like, well, if you set up a system that big, you can only get commercial net metering credits, which are worth, I think, 30% less than residential credits. I don't think you can take the SRECs, and there were other obstacles that made it discriminatory, I think illegal, obstacles for non-solar-sited homeowners to take advantage of photovoltaics. So I'd like to see if we could have legal action taken, or at least change the legislation to enable anybody who has the money, and you can get loans at low interest if you don't have that much money, to be able to invest in photovoltaics. And I gave a position paper to Paul to I think, you know, good public policy ought to be efficient, environmentally sustainable, and equitable. Yeah. And this current situation fails on all three counts.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks, I'll look forward to that. And, you know, the community solar project aspect of the net metering bill is a really critical one.
And community solar is not the same as cooperative solar. Solar is by large corporations from out of town who will let you invest in their project and give you a reduction. I don't know exactly
that's
all
a
the
PPA.
Details. A PPA, power purchase agreement. Anyway, you'll get some reduction in your electric bill, but you won't get any ownership or equity in the project.
Okay. Steve, you were next.
Thank you. Appreciate it. And I'm from East Hampton, so I'm stepping out of the district. I have to agree to represent what you said before. You know, so many people coming on a Saturday afternoon, you've got a great bunch of constituents. It's a great reflection on the district. And a lot of folks have been asking about strategy, so I'm waiting to talk at the end, because I think to Jim's point, if there's what he said, maybe it makes sense, and interested in your thoughts, about merging the budgetary process here with what we're after. You mentioned, for instance, if something emerges out of conference, it's up or down, it's not going to be a hearing process. It would only happen later down the road with the omnibus. So doesn't it make sense, TUE comes up for their budget hearing on Tuesday before Ways and Means. Does it make sense, as Jim was indicating, perhaps to, you know, to put some testimony in and get people in the building? You have a sense of what that's like, but it seems to me, just even if it was this crowd, could have a pretty major impact. It doesn't have to be a one and done. Mm-hmm. It's like you go down to the hearing, testify, and we'll come back another day. But I think, I don't know what your sense is in terms of the presence in the building. You commented earlier about the traction you heard from this on the subsidy thing, which is a message we have to counteract. But what about just the presence in the building?
Yeah.
Starting on Tuesday.
Thank you. So what Steve is referring to is Tuesday is the House and Senate Ways and Means hearing on the subjects of transportation, environment, and energy. That means we scrutinize the governor's budget proposals for what he's proposing to spend on each of those agencies. It includes DPU, it includes the Energy Facility Siting Board, and others that come under the Executive Office of Environment and Energy. So that hearing, I mean, it's always wonderful to have people in the State House stirring things up, but that hearing is only for the administration officials, the secretaries, and commissioners, to explain their proposal to the Ways and Means Committee. So while the meeting is open to the public, and the public is welcome to come, we don't take testimony from the public at that budget hearing. There is a budget hearing that is reserved. There's about 8 budget hearings on different aspects of the budget, where we hear from the administration about their proposal. And there was one hearing, I think it's March 4th, where we hear the public's testimony on any aspect of the budget. So people could come to that hearing, but not Tuesday's hearing. So a week from yesterday, Friday,
March 4th.
Is March
4th at Gardner?
Yes, at Gardner Auditorium.
Yeah. Oh, okay, so yeah. Right, I didn't know that
the second part. Yeah, the second part is the, it's usually a pretty long day because people are talking about every agency and every part of the budget. But people can come and weigh in. But it doesn't have to be a hearing to weigh in and to have an impact.
You can submit just.
You can submit, that's what I was about to say.
Even on Tuesday, it could be submitted, even if it's not heard.
Absolutely. I get daily emails and letters from people, not just from my district, but from around the state, about their opinions about these spending proposals in the governor's budget and what they would like us to do to change them when we get our version of the budget. Those are always welcome. They're, you know, they help us, they inform our decisions. Because, you know, we don't just rubber stamp the governor's budget. When the House comes out with our version of the budget, it will be very different. And we will feel maybe he's shortchanging attention on the DPU. I plan to ask the DPU commissioners on Tuesday some questions about their resources and where they're putting them and how they're making their decisions, which get at some of the issues we're talking about here today. Because they are connected, as you said, the budget with energy policy and procedures, administrative procedures. So always glad to, you know, receive public input, either in person, by email, by phone, by letter, on any aspect of the budget or the policy. And they get considered, absolutely.
I also want to post another, we met with our state representative yesterday too.
We'll
go out and have those meetings.
Yeah, that's great. John Seibeck, he's a great rep. He's good, yeah. Chris, let me just see if there's anyone who hasn't spoken first. Yes, you, and then Tom, and then I'll come back. Okay, then David, and then you, Chris. Yes.
Me?
Yes.
I'm really interested in energy efficiency for low-income households. Mm-hmm. And the MaxSave program puts they have to spend at least 10% for low-income households, and what they do is they just spend 10%. Mm-hmm. And it seems like a lot of people are enjoying the MaxSave energy efficiency program, except for low-income people, especially in renters.
Right.
And it would be good if either that cap was lifted or there was maybe a differential. And the 10%, I think, comes from some estimate of the low-income population in the whole state, rather than by that view, we have a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know.
Okay, I'll look into that. I wasn't familiar with that, but.
It would be nice if more money was available for low-income
families
to get the MaxSave money for energy efficiency.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. Are you talking about the community action
yes.
piece of it?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
This community action that serves the low income right. sector, and they have a huge backlog right now of weatherization yep. projects. It's a waiting list that can take years to fulfill. And it's because of that 10%, essentially a cap. And has something to do with the way the funds are allocated for that purpose.
Right, so the money
that's like a cap, but it's right. actually the minimum.
So the way this works is we all pay a little bit of assessment on our utility bill that goes into that energy conservation program. Yeah. And they're limited 10% to what they can spend on low income.
They're not limited.
Okay, you're saying it's a floor.
That's the floor.
It's a minimum, but it's become the maximum.
They just say that's what it's going to
okay.
be.
Okay. But your understanding is there's nothing written down that says it's the maximum, just that it's the minimum.
It's not, it's the minimum.
Okay. So that's a policy issue.
Yeah, I thought community action was funded a bit differently, too, than just from the utility companies.
No, it's through MassSave.
It's through MassSave.
Yeah.
Well, then they have other funds, but the MassSave program works that way, and it doesn't really seem like it's set up right.
Okay.
Low-income families ought to have way more access to that program than we do.
Thank you. I'll look into that. Absolutely. That's important. Now, I've lost a little track of who I said was next. Tom, you're right.
I am Tom Clark from the Clark Upper Turn in Deerfield. And I want to thank Steve for all the work he's done. We had a rally July of 2 years ago. It was one of the first things got people going around here, and Steve was there. He was with us.
Well, thank you. And Becky's here too, and Ben.
And my son Ben has been very outspoken.
Clark Hill Fruit Farms has done a lot to galvanize and inform people.
And we've taken this whole issue to heart. We bought the pipeline, but then we've also become sustainable. We 2 weeks ago we got a 19 kilowatt system online in action, and we used. Not only are we going to get the SRECs and we're going to get net metering, we were lucky enough to get in under the cap, but we utilized money from the Department of Agriculture, from the Federal Department of Agriculture, as well as Department of Ag Resources for sustainable energy on farms. So it's a wonderful thing for us. But my question is, you know, I'm not going to talk about the legislature or Eversource or whatever. What happens when we become, if we want to become sustainable and produce all of our own electricity in Massachusetts, how do we do that? Well, a sunny day, it's a great idea. But what about night and when it's foggy and when it's, how do we store that power? We can't, am I going to build a little pump storage system on my hill? I don't know, you know. Is Tesla batteries going to do it? I don't know. How are we going to do this? I guess I'm, you know, open to all these energy people here. What's going to happen in the future?
David, well, that actually leads very well, and I won't complain about Eversource, we'll have you know, as a data mission, we've got a lot of things we could discuss there. But one of my questions is, is the legislature looking at the effect on the grid that offline storage is going to have? Because this has been already the first, and like anything else, it's very expensive, and it's the first one, but there's the first bit, speaking of Tesla, they released their first offline storage home battery in it. Not really awesome at the moment, but it's clearly going to have a huge impact down the road, because eventually, if people just completely start, like what I potentially see happens is, with all the frustration that is caused by entrenched businesses, it's going to force people essentially just completely disconnect from the grid completely. And there's a lot of problems that you could end up with energy haves and have-nots, where we put into a dilapidated grid. And we started looking at the effect because, like it or not, that is going to have a massive impact down the road on everything. And it's going to disrupt things. And I think if we don't pay attention to that kind of change, it's very easy to get caught in the trenches in a lot of these detailed arguments. But when you step back and look at the big picture of things like that can solve some of the problems you're talking about, because you can store the energy and then re-release it. And we see a lot of big companies doing that now. For their data centers and things. Mm-hmm. But we started really grappling with that issue at all?
You know, I'm really glad you brought it up, because I've just begun to read about the coming storage issues and availability. So I don't know if they're discussing it as part of the omnibus bill, but I'm going to raise it with the chairman next week, because it should be.
Too soon for that.
Might be too soon, but they should do something in terms of study, research, be ready.
Right.
There ought to be something done at this early stage. So I will bring it up. Thank you.
Thanks.
Ava, and then Chris. Ava.
Hi, I just want to talk about Article 97.
Yes.
For a moment. I wanted to ask you what you thought. I mean, do you think that the people who are not in the pipeline path, mostly in Eastern Mass, do they really get it? Are the legislators, would they vote? You know, will they vote to uphold it? What's your sense of this whole thing? And part two, what do you think we should do about it? Because my impression, I don't read the Globe, I don't know. You know, that they really don't know what's going on with Article
97
about the pipeline. Can you
talk
some more
about that? Sure. So, if anyone doesn't know what Article 97 is, it is a really special part of our state constitution that was adopted in the 1980s by vote of the citizens. It was proposed by the late Senator Bob Wetmore, who passed away not long ago, who was a great environmental champion. And what it says is that any land that is set aside for conservation purposes, protection, public parks, public lands, it includes lands that have conservation restrictions or agricultural preservation restrictions on them. Those lands are protected in perpetuity. They can only be released from those restrictions and used for some alternate purpose, such as a pipeline. With a vote of the legislature, two-thirds of the House and two-thirds of the Senate, and then signed by the governor, is the only way you can remove those protections from those lands. And the NED project would go through many public properties. They have, you know, said they responded to our outcry and they've rerouted, they stay away from public lands. But the last thing I heard was there were still about 100 parcels from the New York border to the end that go through public property. So we made a big deal out of this, and there's a case currently involving the town of Sandusfield, which is a case that would be a real precedent, where Kinder Morgan has their facilities in Connecticut, northwestern Connecticut, need additional capacity. So what they're proposing is to create a, I think, a 3 miles long, basically a loop of a pipeline to add storage capacity to serve their customers in Connecticut. But it happens to be on conservation land in the town of Sandersfield that the state has invested a lot of money in protecting. And I haven't been there, but I'm told it's a really special habitat, that it's really quite unique. So Kinder Morgan got a legislator from the Boston area, because the two local legislators who represent Sandersfield, which is in southern Berkshire County, would not file a bill. Normally, the local legislators file a bill to release something from Article 97. And this does happen occasionally, but usually for a public purpose, like a realignment of a road or the building of a school or something of that nature where there's no other alternative but to release some conservation land. This has nothing to do with that. This is pure, you know, fossil fuel energy, pure green. So Kinder Morgan got a legislator from Boston area, from Hingham, to file this bill, opposed by everyone out here. And there was a hearing. The bill is actually before the State Administration Committee. And we're waiting to see what they will do with that bill. There was a hearing probably 2 months ago, I think, something. Some of you probably came down.
Yes.
That will be very telling, how they decide to, whether they give an adverse report that it shouldn't pass, or bury it in a study. I don't think they're going to approve it. But if they do, I think it would go to the floor of the House and Senate, and I think we have the ability to push it back, because it needs a supermajority to pass. And I think we can mount enough no votes against it to defeat it. Now, that's the kind of thing that would play out on the 100 or so Article 97 parcels that the NED would cross. They would have to file either one major bill or 100 small bills and go through this process over again. A number of us are prepared to fight that strongly on the floor of the House. I'm kind of optimistic that we would be able to defeat it. And if we do, that'd be great. But the problem is that we're in a unique position having Article 97. I'm not aware of any other states that have something like that. And my guess is this would go all the way to the Supreme Court, which is why we're at a critical point. Right. So it'll be adjudicated for sure if we challenge it. I think Massachusetts, so FERC, I think, believes, they haven't been totally clear about this, but I think there's opinions that FERC would not respect Article 97, even if we rejected these releases. And that's what would get litigated. And that would be a test case that would go on for years, which would help make the NED project less economic. Carolyn, and then you. Yeah, go ahead.
I don't want to get off the pipeline subject because, of course, that's dear to my heart. But I did have a question that has been asked over and over again to follow up on Dave and Tom's discussion. In Nevada, and I'm sorry I haven't done a lot of research on it, in Nevada, so many people went solar that the utilities were able to get through the legislature a fee that to use the solar so that it became less economical. And people that have contacted me have been really concerned that we are pushing solar and that the utilities would in fact be able to do this here in Massachusetts. And I was hoping that you could, you know, spearhead something, because here we are trying to be sustainable and then to have the utility companies charge back a fee for using, you know, whatever. I just think it's, like I said, I didn't have enough time to do any research on it, but it's a significant issue, I think, in the long run. We're talking about long run sustainability and encouraging people to go solar.
Thank you. Is anyone familiar with what happened in Nevada? Because I'm not that up to speed on it. Yes, either one.
So basically, Nevada DPU decided, one, that the current systems are not grandfathered in.
Yes.
Now, in Massachusetts, current systems are grandfathered in, so anybody who has installed PV gets their set net metering credits and SRECs and everything else. So they can't touch that here in Massachusetts, although a year ago they did try to do that. So that's one major difference, but there is this minimum bill or fixed charge that Nevada passed. It'll be basically phased in over 12 years from $12 up to $38. It's exorbitant, it's ridiculous. And basically it will negate any of the payback for a lot of people. The other thing to take into account, Nevada electricity rates are lower than in Massachusetts, so we're currently paying 18 to 24 cents a kilowatt hour. In Nevada, it's between 7 and 12. So for them, payback takes a lot longer because the cost of the system is still the same. So the problem is that in Nevada, one, they don't have grandfathering. So everybody got socked with these rates. Hopefully here we will be able to avoid at least that part, but that pits those people who have already put solar up against the future people, which I don't think is fair at all. So it needs to be in this conference committee absolutely crystal clear that we have no minimum bill, no fixed charges, because those are the means by which the utility is trying to make solar uneconomical for the ordinary small person. For commercial industrial users, they could hardly care less if they had to pay an extra $10 or $15. It's not gonna be a deal breaker for them. For all of everyone in this room who puts it on their roof, it will be a deal breaker.
Thank you. John, and there's a gentleman
one word that I wanted to add to what Blair said, and that word is discriminatory.
Yeah.
And that, doing that type of thing, targeting one group of people and putting a charge on that one group of people because they differ from other people is a discriminatory practice, and that should be illegal under DPU rules. And for the legislature to bring something forward to be approved by the DPU should be a non-starter for that reason, if nothing else.
Thanks. Okay. Yes, sir, right there in the doorway. No, gentleman behind you, then you can speak.
Sure, thank you. Sorry to circle the conversation back around, but with regard to what the fellow in the green and white plaid there was talking about, I think there's an opportunity. The phrase which I've heard for what you spoke of is called grid flight, which is, of course, harkening back to white flight from urban areas, which whenever you have flight like that, it's really unfortunate thing that, if there were proper policies, could be avoided. But if the problems around allowing people to net meter and allowing people to connect are not solved, technology will provide the answer, which is people will grid flight.
Yeah.
And it's the people who are rich, who have the money, will leave first, meaning that all the poor people will be propping up a system, and it will fail for that reason. And so we really need to encourage, from this point of view, people to stay on the grid, which means we need to co-opt grid flight so that people do stay on the grid. People will net meter and still, because people will install the technology one way or the other. It will be affordable.
Thank you. Yes, sir, now your turn.
About 20 years ago, I was very interested in perpetuity protections for land, and I found a book that reviewed how this worked in the various states, and it cited Massachusetts as being one of the worst for protecting lands for perpetuity. So I wouldn't be so optimistic. I think that this, it could be a big battle to prevent that from happening.
I anticipate a big battle if it plays out the way we just discussed and it goes to court. It certainly will be. It'll be a states' rights issue. It will be an issue of whether an unelected administrative agency like FERC can override a provision of our Constitution. It's not just a law that was passed in the legislature. It's something that's part of our Constitution voted in by the citizens. It would be a huge case, I think. Yeah. Anyone else?
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, back to Article 97. There's been some rumors or whatever about Charlie Baker instructing, that was the word used, state property to allow Kinder Morgan to survey. Do you know anything about this?
I do. The question was some rumors. I just became aware of it Tuesday that the governor had instructed the environmental agencies, DCR, game, and so on, to allow Kinder Morgan survey access to state property. So I heard the rumor as well, checked with the governor's office, and that has not happened. It has not happened yet. It could happen, but no, the Kinder Morgan is not allowed, currently not allowed on state property for surveying. But it's something, you know, we're watching very carefully. The administration knows that there are a significant number of legislators who are very, very opposed to this, as well as citizens. So,
so this is not just Article 97 land. This is all state properties.
Yes, but so that's right.
So where did this rumor come from? I mean,
I don't know. I have no idea. I know there are lots of rumors out there. I hear rumors all the time.
I have a quick comment that it seems to me that the language of long drawn out litigation and a case that could go to the Supreme Court is the kind of language that utility companies are going to understand.
Right.
And perhaps that should be talked about.
Very good. Yeah, I agree. Okay, Chris, you can get another bike here.
Hi. Okay, three things quick. Steve, you already signed on to the storage thing. I don't know if you know, it was part of the Eldridge Coulter bill.
Okay.
Became Downing's.
Okay.
And it's five paragraphs down the clear anyway.
Okay.
So what they're talking about is a modernized grid that would store solar. And so anybody, for all you, does the number 1600 megawatts ring a bell?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that was our last governor's idea goal for solar. How much, what's the percentage of the grid that would occupy? Anybody know? 8%. So we're in no danger of flooding the grid with renewable solar. Not for now. But the study was, that you signed on to, mm-hmm. was if we get to that point, wouldn't that be nice in 2030, to say that 25 or 50% was renewable energy produced here in Massachusetts? Wouldn't that be great?
Yeah.
Or hydro and all the rest. The second thing, municipal. Municipal is exempt from net metering. We have a lot of our members are running into this problem out in Concord and Harvard and other places where their local municipal energy people there are saying no net metering. You know, you can put the energy out back on the grid, but we're not going to pay you for it. So, but you can do that.
These are the municipal light companies,
yes,
the
right.
30 or so, 40 of them that exist.
Right. Some of them do. I believe Westfield does, and I believe South Hadley does. But a lot of them have said, no, we don't really want to do that. The third thing is MSOA's new position on this whole cap of net metering. We're capping the wrong thing, folks.
Mm-hmm.
We should be capping fossil fuels.
Yeah.
We should go back and we should take the Paris Accords. We should go back to 2005, take 10% off of that, and say that's how much you can import into our state. Anything above that is like a carbon tax. Problem with the carbon tax is how do you make it work? If you take it from the beginning and say, no, you can only import so much gasoline, so much natural gas, so much oil. Guess what happens? People race to renewables, don't they? How many more electric cars are you going to get?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
This could be the incentive. This is what the Omnis energy bill should be about.
Thank you.
Yeah.
One or two more questions?
Okay.
Sort of call it
okay.
Today.
Sure.
Just clarification on the net metering bills that you're reconciling with the commission. Are you dealing with co-op or community solar so that the net metering reimbursement would be the same as if you had it on your home?
The type of co-op that Paul Newland spoke about?
Yeah.
Okay. I brought the text with me. I'd have to look that up unless somebody knows that.
You mean on the House bill?
on either one, House or Senate bills in conference town, do they deal with cooperatives?
So there's language saying that low-income and community-shared solar, that they should exist.
Right.
But there isn't any provision to a specifically make that economically viable.
Right.
And in fact, if the net metering credit is anything below full retail, none of those will exist.
So it should be $100
Yeah, it should be 100%.
Because, I mean, it does discriminate against people who can't put it on their homes.
Right, right. Which is 70% of 70 to 80% of people in Massachusetts don't have direct southern exposure, so that they get second home.
So they should have the same advantages, credits, reimbursements as those who have them on their home, on their property.
Agreed. I saw a hand in the back there. Yes.
Yeah, I just along with the Article 97, there's another issue that will come up with the omnibus energy bill, and that is there'll be another bite at the apple to try to overrule the home rule provision with respect to land-based turbines. Mm-hmm. And so I really hope that you continue your advocacy as Ben Downing has to try to keep that from becoming a part of the bill, which it seems to every year and almost got passed several years ago.
I will certainly do that. It was one of the most fun things I've done in the legislature the last 5 years was to run out the clock on that. At the end of the session, about 4 or 5 years ago in the House, the Senate had passed the land-based wind bill and was waiting for final enactment. And it was on the House side as the clock approached midnight. And a couple of my colleagues and I continued to talk about it until it reached midnight and the speaker had to close the session for the year, so it died. That's what you were talking about. It was a lot of fun. Yeah. So thank you. All right, so maybe one more?
One more question.
One more question? Sure. Carolyn?
I just wanted to follow up. Did you, now that we know that gas is being exported up to Canada, or it's been approved anyway, what happened to the royalty tax that you had filed to tax gas for export?
Yep.
Can we, if is that dead, or can we reintroduce it, or what?
It's in committee, so it hasn't been decided on. So the date by which committees have to report on bills is coming up on March 16th. The committees will decide whether bills are going to move forward or whatever. I love that idea. It came from an attorney in Conway originally. I thought it was very clever. And I will continue to push it. Hopefully they will give it a favorable recommendation in committee.
Do you need another letter from the municipalities to back that up?
Well, I think I've got one for Airfield, right?
Yeah.
I don't need a new one. No, your letter was excellent. It does the job. So,
Well, I want to thank Steve for coming out today.